When my family moved to the countryside, we were all excited about a fresh start. We found a charming old farmhouse surrounded by rolling fields, the kind of place you only see in picture books. It was quiet, secluded, and seemed like the perfect spot for my parents to live out their dream of raising animals and planting gardens. It didn't take long for us to settle in, filling the house with laughter and the smells of home-cooked meals. But there was one thing that felt off from the very beginning, the Scarecrow. It stood in the middle of the field just behind our house, a tattered thing with straw poking out of its burlap sack head and a faded flannel shirt hanging off its stick-thin frame. Its hat was old, torn at the brim, and from the back porch you could make out its hollow eyes, two black pits that seemed to watch over the land. I asked my dad about it on our first day here, but he just shrugged, saying it came with the property. "Probably been here for years," he said, ruffling my hair. "Good to have something keeping an eye on things out there." I laughed it off and tried to ignore it. After all, scarecrows were just a part of life on a farm, right? But as the weeks went on, I noticed something strange. Every morning, the scarecrow seemed to be facing a different direction. Sometimes it looked towards the house, other times it was angled toward the road, and once it even appeared to be turned directly toward my bedroom window. I figured it was just the wind shifting it, or maybe the birds messing with it, but no matter how many times I tried to tell myself that, a creeping unease started to settle in. One night, as I was getting ready for bed, I looked out my window and froze. There, standing in the field, was the scarecrow, facing directly toward my window, its empty eyes fixed on me. I stared at it, feeling my skin crawl, and pulled the curtains shut, trying to shake off the feeling that it was watching me. The next morning, I mentioned it to my mom, but she just laughed. "Honey, it's just a scarecrow. They're supposed to be a little creepy, right?" I tried to brush it off, to act like it didn't bother me, but as the days passed, things only got stranger. One evening, as the sun was setting, I went outside to help my dad with some yard work. I glanced over at the scarecrow and felt my stomach drop. It had moved closer to the house. Just a few feet, but I was sure it hadn't been that close before. I didn't say anything, not wanting to sound paranoid, but I could feel its hollow gaze following me as I worked. That night, I woke up to a sound outside my window. It was faint, like the rustling of leaves, but more deliberate. I held my breath, listened as the sound grew louder, closer. Slowly, I got out of bed and pulled the curtain back, peeking out into the darkness. The scarecrow was gone. I blinked, thinking maybe I was seeing things, but no matter how hard I looked, it wasn't there. The field was empty, the moonlight casting long shadows across the grass. Heart pounding, I crept downstairs, hoping my dad was still awake, but as I reached the kitchen, I stopped dead in my tracks. There, just outside the back door, stood the scarecrow. Its head was tilted to the side, as if it were studying me, its empty eyes glinting in the faint light. Straw jutted out from the rips in its clothes, and its twisted mouth seemed to form a strange, lopsided grin. I backed away slowly, feeling a cold sweat break across my skin. I ran back upstairs, locking my door, and spent the rest of the night wide awake, listening for any sounds from outside. But the house was silent, the only noise my own ragged breathing. In the morning, the scarecrow was back in its usual spot in the field, facing away from the house. I tried to convince myself it had just been a nightmare. Maybe I was letting my imagination get the better of me. But that day, I noticed something new. A set of footprints in the dirt, leading me from the field to our back door. They were small, just the size of my own feet, and they left a trail of crushed grass and broken twigs. That night, I locked all the doors and windows, feeling my pulse race as I double-checked each lock. But in the middle of the night, I heard it again, the rustling outside my window, soft and slow. And then a new sound. A soft tap, tap, tapping at my window. I lay frozen, listening as the tapping grew louder, more insistent, each knock sending a shiver down my spine. Gathering my courage, I glanced toward the window, heart racing. There, pressed against the glass, was the face of the Scarecrow. Its burlap sack head was tilted to the side, the hollow eyes staring straight into mine. Its mouth was twisted in the same unsettling grin, and the hat hung low over its straw-stuffed head. It was waiting. I stumbled back, scrambling to lock my door, trying to tell myself it wasn't real. But the tapping continued, soft and rhythmic, like it knew I was there, like it knew I couldn't ignore it. In the morning, the Scarecrow was back in the field. I tried to tell my parents, tried to explain that something was wrong, that something wasn't right with the Scarecrow, but they just brushed it off, telling me I was being silly, that I was letting my imagination get the best of me. But I know what I saw. And every night, I still hear the tapping at my window, soft and insistent. Each morning, the Scarecrow is back in the field, closer than when it was before. And every time I look at it, I can swear its twisted smile is just a little wider.